how much are you seeing the bank market really step back from the small business borrower? Are you seeing banks start to tighten there or elsewhere in a significant way?
Well, that's a long-term trend that we have been seeing. So the banks probably in the private loan market were 20% plus market share 10, 15 years ago. They're down inside of 10%, moving towards 5% market share. So that's a long secular trend, and that's being replaced by private credit from people like us. I think that will continue. And whenever we have these periods of crisis where the banks focus on their loan books and focus on loan losses, the regulators follow that focus, we see them pull back even more, and that's happening in this crisis as well.
So given that you have so much dry powder as well, and you're open in these markets right now, where are you looking to spend money in private markets? Is there certain things that you wouldn't invest in at this point in time?
Well, I think there are a couple of things I'd point out. First of all, credit, and I think it's important to differentiate that we manage credit. So credit's a little different than equities. Credit can be both strategic and tactical. So by strategic, I mean that you look at what's the underlying business doing? Are you in the right sectors? Do they have the wind at their back? You look at long-term themes. Do you like fixed income? Do you like floating rate paper? Those kind of strategic decisions. And then there are the tactical decisions in credit. Where do I want to be in the capital structure? Senior secured? Do I want to be junior in the capital structure and try to make a little higher return? And the great news about our business is we can do both of those things. And right now for us, we want to strategically be in higher quality credits because we don't know where this economy is going to go, how long we're going to be in this shutdown. And so we want to be cautious about where we're going strategically. And then tactically, we're going to be higher up in the capital structure, senior secured, so we can be protected if something goes wrong. And I'd say that is where private lending fits.
When you're taking a look at liquid markets right now, are there any distortions that you see? What concerns you, if anything, about the liquid markets right now after so much monetary policy?
Well, I worry about the fact that rates are so low today that the wind that's been at our back as investors for a long, long time of falling rates, we don't have that in the credit markets. Now, investment grade is inside of 2%. So you're getting duration risk. So you're having long-term, you're making long-term investment decisions. And you really don't today know how long rates are going to stay this low. So I worry that as you see rates start to tick back up, which I don't think is going to happen in the real near term, but over time, as those rates tick back up, those fixed income exposures, you're going to have to be really careful about because you're not getting a lot of yield to offset an increase or a decrease in pricing caused by an increase in rate. So I'm cautious about that.
How does that change the way you underwrite your expectations here?
Well, once again, it gets us back to this difference between the private world and the public world. On our public strategies, we are definitely moving higher in the value chain. We want better companies, better management, strong sponsors in our leveraged loan business because we believe those businesses will outperform and they'll grow into their capital structures or grow into less leverage. So that's how we're managing that on our levered loan side, for instance. On our private side, we're able to kind of jump in there and take advantage of dislocation. So if a company is coming to the market, if a sponsor, a private equity firm wants to buy a public company, they can't really finance that in the bank markets because they need full committed capital. So we can step in there and provide significant capital. We did that for a large chemical acquisition in Europe this year, where we provided half of the financing they needed before they made their bid, and then they went out and placed the rest of it later. And so I think those kind of situations in this kind of market will be where we are more aggressive.
It's funny, I was about to just ask you, you know, in the heat of the pandemic, what kinds of risks you're not worth taking, but you just pointed to an opportunity there. It's worth asking you then, what opportunities are you seeing to put money to work? What looks like the most investable opportunities?
I want to be careful because we are being cautious. We've been talking to our investors about this concept of cautiously active for the last 6 months. And what we've described that as, we are worried about where this pandemic leads. We don't really have great insight into when we'll be back in theaters or we'll be back on airlines. And so we've been cautious about that. But we've been active because the higher quality names traded off with the lower quality names, and we were able to invest in those, and the private market shut down and began to reopen, and we were able to invest in that. And so we believe that there's always going to be an opportunity. I'll give you an example. We did across Blackstone, so in the credit business, in our life sciences business, in some of our other businesses, we provided $2 billion to this company called Alnylam this year in the middle of the crisis, in the form of royalty, in the form of a loan, in the form of some equity. And that $2 billion was critical to that company to push through this cycle and to grow. And so I think we'll always see those opportunities, and we'll try to make sure we use the value of our platform, the scale, the broad nature of our products, because those things will give us those one-off, take a shot and do something really important in these markets. At the same time, we'll continue to make the investments in the public side of our business.
Well, that leads to the question also. I think that this crisis has led to a lot of creative financings. And you've heard the banks start to talk about it. Interesting new uses of collateral. You've seen retail businesses that are particularly troubled use real estate as collateral. We know real estate is also a troubled business through this pandemic. How do you feel about some of these new structured deals?
By the way, I think it's the wonderful thing about credit. Is you can look at all these different things in all these different ways. And all people are doing is they're trying to provide capital to these companies in a protected way. And it's the unique thing about our business. We are not buying the same type of stock that every stock picker buys. So I like that. And we actually are growing our structured products business dramatically right now because of that. Because when companies are going through cycles, when they're going through real challenges, if you can get to the right asset base, you can provide them the capital they need without taking inordinate risk. And I think that's going to continue to be a focus for all of us, and it'll be a focus for the market.
We here at Bloomberg have been calling this the credit disconnect. It seems to us that high yield, even investment grade, record amounts of issuance in public markets. But it seems that a lot of small businesses are still seeing a lot of closures. They're running out of PPP money. They're finding it hard to get loans from their banks. Why this disconnect? How are you seeing this disconnect play out?
Well, as I said earlier, I think the disconnect is simply because access to capital has a direct correlation to how large you are as a business. There is no doubt about that. That's always been true. That continues to be true. And so the smaller businesses are having a harder time finding access to capital. I do think some of that structured transaction work that you talked about just in the last conversation or last question will trickle down to these smaller businesses, because that is how you get money into the hands of individuals, into retail buyers, and that helps with those businesses. But the fiscal stimulus was designed to focus as much as it could on the large markets. It had great success in doing that. I think the next fiscal stimulus will focus more on those smaller companies, the smaller borrowers. That's not really where we play, but I think there is a place for the fiscal stimulus to help there.